From the day your ghost woke you, your light has been our beacon. You defended this city from the worst the darkness sent against us. Atheon, Crota, Oryx, Axis. When you are called on, you will do it again. The city's children tell your story to each other. Pretending to be guardians, they grow braver and more powerful with each retelling. They are no longer afraid. You have shown them, and you have shown me, what it is to hope. You have led us to a new age, Guardian. An age of triumph and remembrance. Today and tomorrow and every day, you fight for us. You fight for the Traveler. You fight for those who fled here from a thousand nations looking for refuge. We thank you, Guardian. And we will never forget.
Out there, Hunter?
The Hive Bane. Superb. The darkness is waiting for you, Hive Bane.
Okay.
Good to see you, my friend.
Yeah, well, screw him.
Oryx is gone, but his armies remain.
accused of killing Jonathan Thibson.
Welcome to the stream, fellas.
Because of mental incapacity, sitting in the dark seems totally unconcerned by what is happening to him.
I recall very clearly that during this trial, while Sandy Charles was in the prisoner's box, he had grown his fingernails to a very long. His fingernails were very long. And,
I can't wait for Destiny 2. Eventually, I get here.
Disturbing way, and with his long fingernails, he would scratch the wood of the prisoner's box. And it was quite disconcerting to go with this behavior just a few feet behind me.
His lawyer, Barry Singer, attempts to establish the psychological profile of his client. Sandy's childhood was miserable, and a miserable childhood can render such children vulnerable to outside influences. His fondness for horror films and the occult affected his
childhood. I think this case dealt with a young man who was suffering from a delusion. It's a mental health issue. A delusion. There certainly was an aspect of the movie Warlock and the gruesome killing that took place in the movie as related
what
to
the
acts
fuck?
That Sandy Charles did. But I can't say that the occult or devil worship or anything like that had anything to do with the murder of Jonathan Thibson. This was a delusional young man who committed a horrible crime.
No!
Warlock could be considered Sandy Charles.
Okay, ammo. Came in just in time.
Judge Gary Albright finds Sandy Charles not criminally responsible due to mental incapacity. The teenager is then sent to the Psychiatric Institute of North Battleford, Saskatchewan.
Whether or not Sandy Charles deceived anyone with respect to whether or not he was insane within the meaning of the law.
Alright. I'm not going to go out there because it's probably got rockets trained. Just camp over here for a little bit. Get the special. Alright. Keep back the ground for fun. Alright, now let's go in. Everyone's probably burned up most of the special. Heavy. Except for that guy.
Sandy Charles takes advantage of a careless mistake by prison guards and escapes.
Sandy Charles, was sent to the forensic hospital in
scary.
From there, Sandy Charles escaped. When he escaped, he crossed the river, crossed the Saskatchewan River. A fairly large manhunt was undertaken to locate Sandy Charles. Sandy Charles was captured the very next day. He's now incarcerated.
Oh shit. Scary. It's getting scary.
Is described as being extremely dangerous. In June 2000, Sandy Charles.
We gotta get B. Go. Attacking a prisoner. No time to explain why we have no time to explain.
Religion is based on the nearly universal fear of eternity.
Oh, come on, capture it already. Teabag.
Many impressionable young minds fall under the devil's spell.
Shit, I have to see.
Fulfill their hopes and desires. They forget that this monster only knows how to take, never to give. The first crime these fragile young people commit is the first step of a long descent into hell.
Oh, and I got sniped. What? Terrible. Two, one, special. Oh God. No. How could I stop that? Isaluna, fucking Arcanine.
Many roads can lead to madness, but once the human spirit loses itself in the unfathomable trap of mental pathology, it's hard to find a way out. In this universe without markers, the entire world...
Oh, I got the Jade Rabbit.
...where all of Irelia's threat lead to the beast we are so desperately trying to escape.
Oh man, I'm pretty sure my fucking bounty is to get like pulse rifle kills, not sidearm kills. Oh man, if I can aim. Uh oh. Got him. Blue assisted. No! Well, that works. Fuck. No! Bottom of the list. Watch out, because I'm on the bottom of the list.
Toronto.
Don't worry, I got my wormwood. The meta hasn't changed. Alright, here we go.
As night begins to fall,
let's go back here. Let's camp back here.
Hardly knows. With the help of a few neighbors, the worried parents start looking. But unfortunately, find no trace of the child. More and more besides themselves as the evening progresses, they decide to notify the Toronto police. It is now a little after 8 p.m. Police cars are sent to patrol the area between King Street and Lakeshore. Other officers on foot go over the Parkdale section with
everyone.
A little after 2:30 a.m., police officers Jack Smith
shot
by his body. He is lying on his back behind some bushes. Morris, a 9-year-old boy residing at 304B Queen Street, tells his parents that he is going to see a movie at the local theater. That will be the last they see of him. Police officers searched the area for several days without results. A week later, Morris's dead body is discovered at Cherry Beach in the eastern part of the city. The child has been strangled and savagely beaten. Just like Wayne Millette, Gary Morris has also been undressed, and then his clothes put back on. His killer has bitten him on the throat, and a handful of paper clips have been left around the body, as if part of a ritual. The day of his disappearance, Morris is seen on a bike with a teenager riding double. For the police detectives, the presence of a bicyclist, probably the same person, on the murder scenes of both Wayne Millette and Gary Morris is hardly a coincidence. On October 12th, the officers in charge of the investigation show journalists a sketch of what they believe to be the killer's bicycle. On Saturday, January 19th, a young girl named Carol Voice also disappears. On this exceptionally mild winter day, the 4-year-old girl is playing outside with a friend. This friend, a young boy, later tells police that a tall guy had taken the little girl for a ride on his bike. He describes him as a teenager wearing a dark windbreaker.
Oops.
For the third time in a few months, this unidentified bicyclist is linked to a child's abduction. The press loses no time reporting the girl's disappearance. Unfortunately, at 11:09 p.m., Agent 32 of the Toronto Police
Department. What's that noise?
Discovered the young girl's middle name. The police investigators who have been on the search for little Wayne Millette get a point of time of deja vu. The little girl has been savagely beaten, and her aggressor seems to have acted out of force. The cause of death is listed as perforation of the internal organs, prompted by the insertion of a branch into the vagina. Solving Carol Boyce's murder is made the number one priority of the internal police. More than 2,300 policemen are put on the case and given orders to question all residents and thoroughly search the area. At that moment, two policemen remembered the story of a teenager, a certain Peter Woodcock, who had been interrogated back in March 1956, 6 months before the first murder, about a strange case of assault on a 10-year-old girl. A murderer gets labeled a serial killer after his third victim. Studies done on such criminals have shown that this desire to kill often manifests itself early, even very early in childhood. Where does this urge to kill come from? Are they born killers?
Shucks. Let's hold that guy over.
It's pretty clear, though, from the research that antisocial behavior has a high genetic load, and antisocial behavior includes everything from theft to violent crimes.
Antisocial behavior.
What we call sociopaths or psychopaths.
Sociopaths.
The genetic load is enormous. It's 80% or more. And there's no shared environmental influence. So it seems like for psychopathic killers, it's all genetics. And for other killers, it's a combination of bad genes and bad environment.
In France, the case of Guillaume Pillon, alias Guy Georges, is a perfect illustration of the road taken by a psychopath. Society has been unable to check.
Guy Georges, right from the beginning, Guy Georges was an unwanted child. Rather than raising him herself, his
back
mother,
to
Elena Hopkins, hired two different nannies
so
to
have a chance to take it.
But she did not
get
them in the
region.
Her own parents, the grandparents of the child, knew nothing of his existence. His father, George Cartwright, a black soldier based near Paris, whom the child never met, was never involved in his upbringing. Things got wrong from the very start, and he winds up in the care of social services called ADASS in France. Being abandoned by his family is one of the problems he has, but his very identity is another, because his birth name is Guy Georges Rampillon. But at the age of 6, government authorities shortened it to Guy Georges. Also from the start, he is a kid who has to deal with problems of race. He is sent to the Morez, a foster family near Angers, in the Maine and Loire region of France, where he is one of nearly 20 children, both foster children and biological children of their foster parents. To add to all this, he is also the only black child in the entire region. He's the brunt of his schoolmates' nasty remarks, calling him such names as Snowball. Throughout his whole childhood, Georges waits to meet a father figure who, sadly, never shows up. He's different from other serial killers in that he's never mistreated in his foster home. Among serial killers, we often observe a combination of psychological, physical, and sexual abuse.
What?
In this case, this combination is
There's two, you guys.
Already, at age 6 or 7,
his
teachers describe him as lazy, demanding, a bully, and from there, things just continue going downhill.
I will teabag you back, guy.
At home, his behavior becomes more and more.
Alright. I screwed up big time when I took C. And I'm not even paying attention to them. But let's go get Aiden. You got your back, bruh.
From books he had read, Guy Georges invents a personality for himself based on Joe the Indian, a hero in the adventures of Tom Sawyer. Between the ages of 8 and 11, he would go out on long hunts in the forest, patiently tracking animals, staying immobile for a long period of time, then killing them, and cutting them up when he had caught them.
At 14, he tries to strangle one of his adoptive sisters, Oseline, a mentally retarded child.
Lors de la première agression de Guy Georges sur une de ses sœurs voulait, quand il a 14
ans. When he's 14, his attempt to strangle his sister is attributed to some kind of argument between adolescent siblings.
Donc, il n'y a aucun...
And nothing further is done.
Christiane. 2 ans plus tard,
2 years later, Guy Georges, who is now 16 years old, tries to strangle another of his sisters, 10 years older than him. The incident happens in the attic of the Morin's house, where an argument breaks out. He attacks her and tries to strangle her from behind, using an iron bar. He's very nearly able to succeed, but being that she's the much stronger one of the two, she's able to break free.
Hearing Christian's cries, the Morins come running to her rescue and find Guy prostrate, his eyes rolling, totally beside himself.
She would later tell the court that it was attempted murder. Guy Georges exhibits this behavior early in his life.
This time they understand something has to be done, and quickly.
He's put in the care of a psychologist and of a family doctor.
Oh, this was heavy.
Once again, they write it off as a one-time occurrence, and as such, there will not be any psychological follow-up or any further treatment.
On Tuesday, February 6, 1979, Guy Georges, with a smile on his face, attacks a young woman getting off a bus. He is arrested, but still being a minor, the judge sends him to prison for 1 week. Guy Georges is dangerous, but everyone just looks the other way. On May 5th, 1980, he assaults another woman, age 24. He steals her handbag, and when she tries to resist, Georges hits her violently before fleeing. The victim does lodge a formal complaint, but the investigation leads nowhere. Yet again,
what? That's trash.
Later on, he attacks 2 young women, attempting to steal their handbags, grabbing them, and drawing a knife into their jaw. And for no good reason, since he already had the bags.
At his trial, the teenager is cocky and self-assured. The psychologists who examine him describe him as an immature, unstable, and impulsive boy. They add that Guy Georges is dangerous, subject to sudden fits, all the more violent as they have been repressed for long periods. One of the experts even goes so far as to label him a psychopath. At 17, Guy Georges has already perpetrated 5 assaults on women, of which 4 come dangerously close to attempted murder. For all these assaults, the court sentences him to a year in prison in a juvenile detention center. Once again, no one says it. No one does it. Guy Georges is released on February 10, 1991. Back on the street again, he hooks up with the homeless of Paris, where he is right at home.
The real career of Guy Georges as a serial killer began in 1991 with the murder of Pascal Escarfal, the first of 5 crimes, all of them murders he admitted to.
Reconnu par Guy Georges. Et à ce moment-là,
at the time he killed Pascal Escarfal, Guy Georges was on conditional leave and on parole.
D'ailleurs,
in fact, most of the time he was out on parole from the prison of Caen, where he was incarcerated for the attempted murder of Pascal Nix in Nancy. Most of these times, Guy Georges would commit either rape or murder.
Soit des viols, soit des meurtres.
In March 1998, Guy Georges is once again arrested coming out of the Blanche metro station.
The jury's verdict at the Criminal Court of Paris regarding Guy Georges, accused of 7 murders, was conformed with the prosecution's demands, a life sentence with no possibility of liberation before 22 years.
Guy Georges does not become a serial killer overnight. His attacks grow more violent over time. He starts in the schoolyard, and then he attacks his sisters, and moves on to strangers, before graduating to rape and murder. Could his future crimes have been prevented? And how? Can a psychopath even be treated?
Quasiment tous les tueurs.
There is always a certain progression in any serial killer's career. Up to a certain point, almost all serial killers can be called ordinary criminals, despite their extraordinary crimes, such as rape, torture, violence, and even serial killing. Guy Georges is like all serial killers, in France or all the world over. They begin with acts of cruelty to animals and theft, then move on to more serious crimes. But they remain delinquents, and their crimes get worse.
In many respects, the paths taken by serial killers are quite typical, whether the killer's name is Guy Georges or Peter Woodcock. In Toronto in 1956, policemen are on the trail of a similar criminal psychopath. While Toronto police are trying to put a name to the mystery bike rider they suspect of having murdered Carol Boyce, agents George Douglas and Neville Little of the North York District are reminded of a strange incident involving a certain Peter Woodcock. A few months earlier, the mother of a 10-year-old girl had informed the police that her daughter was seeing a much older boy, who was about 16, and she was worried that this Peter Woodcock would involve her daughter in his unsavory activities.
There was the incident involving another child where he tried to talk the girl into committing suicide. She already had problems and that he worked on her.
So the day after her call, agents Douglas and Little go to the residence of Frank and Susan Maynard, Woodcock's adoptive parents, to advise them to keep an eye on Peter. Upon seeing the suspect's sketch, both agents Douglas and Little are struck by how much this ghost bike rider resembles Peter Woodcock. On January 21st, 1957, at around 3 p.m., policemen pick up the teenager after class in front of Bloordale College, where he is a student.
He had a background that is extremely common to people who become serial killers. He was born to a woman who just chose to give him up to Children's Aid, to Children's Services in Eastern Ontario. And apparently she had other children, but for some reason she gave them up. And in those days, the Children's Aid often would take a baby that was put for adoption and have it placed in different hospitals, one after the other after the other. What they wanted to do is keep the children from getting, the families from getting too attached to the babies until they found the home where they would be staying. It was a terrible thing to do to babies, to take a baby, constantly moving it, constantly separating it. I think it probably had a lot to do with the formation of the psyche, perhaps.
At three, he is entrusted to the care of Frank and Susan Maynard, a middle-class Toronto couple.
He was quite fortunate where he was placed. He ended up in the Menard family, who were quite a good family. They were well off. His father was a businessman in Toronto and an accountant. There was a son slightly older than Peter who was a law student who became a lawyer, quite a good lawyer. And the mother of the family stayed at home. She worked with Peter as hard as she could to try to do something about his problems, which became very obvious.
Peter's problems do not go away. And taking care of him becomes a full-time job for Susan Maynard. The child is withdrawn, off in his own world. Once, when he is home alone, he breaks the neck of the family's pet canary. Peter has no friends, and at school, other people make fun of him. At 10, he starts inventing macabre fantasies.
At one point, when he was 10 years old, he told a children's service worker that he'd like to set off a big explosive, big bomb at the Canadian National Exhibition and kill all the children there.
Hoping to correct his behavioral problems, Peter's sent to the Sunnyside Children's Center in Kingston, an institution for problem children. 2 years later, he befriends a depressive 10-year-old girl who tried to kill herself several times. Driven by morbid curiosity, Peter offers to accompany the girl into a wooded area where he would kill her, a kind of assisted suicide.
He has this ability to zero in on people who have problems. Finding people, connecting with them, and working on them to do strange things. That this girl wanted to kill herself. Part of that, her parents figured out what was going on and brought the police into it.
But action by agents Douglas and Little of the Toronto Police, who had been called by the little girl's mother, thwart the sinister plans. As the months go by, the teenager continues to fantasize. He imagines himself to be the all-powerful leader of an army of 500 invisible soldiers he calls the Winchester Heights Street Gang. Riding his gleaming bicycle, he cruises the streets of Toronto, dreaming of expanding his domination everywhere.
He developed this fantasy world of gang members, his little pals, all over the city. So, like, in his mind, he had thousands of friends and he interacted with them in all kinds of ways, and he was, like, popular. He was all the things that he wasn't in real life. And this is one of the first really big fantasies that we know about with Peter Wincott. And his whole, like, life as a young man and as an adult has turned on these huge fantasies. And once in a while, the fantasy world interferes with the real world where for some reason somebody has to be sacrificed to the Winchester Heights gang.
He assaults a number of children. He chokes them until they lose consciousness and takes their clothes off. His fantasy seems to be limited to looking at their genitals, but many of these children would never speak of their assaults. In September 1956, Peter Wincott knows he is ready to move on to the next stage of his initiation. Murder.
So the first murder was at the Toronto Exhibition Grounds, the Canadian National Exhibition, and it's around Labor Day. Shortly afterwards, he picked up a young kid and killed him there. And it was only later that fall that he picked up another boy, took him to an area of the Toronto Harbor called Cherry Beach, which is a sort of decrepit industrial area, and molested and killed that boy.
On January 19th, 1957, the weather is unusually warm for winter's day. Peter Wincott takes advantage of this opportunity to go out for a bike ride. At 3:15 p.m. in front of a Danforth Avenue residence, he sees 4-year-old Carol Boyce playing with Johnny Aw, a boy her age.
One day he was out riding his bicycle, and he asked her to go for a ride on his bicycle with her. And he took her to a ravine in Toronto, and there he choked her and violated her and left her dead.
There was a lot more rage to the boy's murder, something where he really took it out on her for being a girl. So he didn't just, strip her and sexually sort of probe at her, but he also attacked the body of her, really tried to mess her up.
In the case of all three murders, witnesses had seen Wincott riding his bicycle in the vicinity. Some had even seen him in the company of children. Little by little, the noose around him is tightening.
The thing that got him caught, there were a couple of things that got him caught. One was that this was in wintertime, and he was riding a bicycle, and it just seemed strange to people. Otherwise, because he had talked to a whole bunch of children, he was just picking up a child, there were eyewitnesses who put together quite a good composite sketch. In fact, his brother saw the composite sketch and said, "That looks like you," his adopted brother.
Sketch.
On January 21st, 2 days after Carol Boyce's murder, Peter Wincott is arrested. Psychopaths suffer from a behavior disorder characterized by the denial of a person's individuality. It is an impulsive and antisocial behavior that can lead to crime and murder. However, we must point out, not all psychopaths inevitably become murderers.
In more than 99% of all cases, serial killers are what we call psychopaths. Psychopaths are not mentally ill. What they suffer from is called a behavioral disorder. Since 99% of serial killers are able to distinguish good and evil at the time of their crimes, the law holds them responsible for their actions, and thus, deemed able to stand trial. Obviously, every psychopath is not a serial killer, but nearly every serial killer is a psychopath.
That being said, for some unknown reason, clinical statistics show that men afflicted with this disorder are 3 times more likely than women to commit crimes.
There's all kinds of reasons why it might be more male, but certainly all the factors that we know about point to the fact that you're going to get a higher representation of males in extreme crimes than law.
Perhaps that is why women really stand out when they are the perpetrators of such crimes, and even more so when the murderer is a young girl. Newcastle upon Tyne lies on the eastern coast of England, midway between Manchester and Edinburgh in Scotland. On May 25th, 1968, some teenagers are playing in a vacant building.
At the end of May, in 1968, there was a little boy named Martin Brown. He was 4 years old, but he was very big by his size. He was very independent as well. Later that day, some boys were foraging through number 85 St. Margaret's Row, a condemned building. These boys were looking for scraps, for sticks, whatever they could find in the house. The boys went upstairs, and they saw what they thought was a little boy sleeping in the corner. They got closer, and they realized this boy was not sleeping. Something had happened to him.
Frightened, the teenagers call out to 2 nearby workers.
The boys panic and call for the workmen downstairs.
While one of the workers runs for help, the other tries to revive the child, but it is already too late.
So the police are called, and they find Martin Brown. It's very odd because it doesn't look like anything really happened.
When are we going to get Destiny 2?
They do notice there's some pills lying about, and I think some empty bottles. They assume that perhaps he poisoned himself eating some pills he assumed were candy. Oddly enough, though, the toxicology report comes back. There's no sign of anything in Martin's blood. Nobody knows how he died. As Martin's mother was grieving, one day, not too long after he died, she gets a knock on the door. She opens the door, and there stands a 10-year-old girl named Mary Bell.
The young girl asks if she could see Martin. The weeping mother answers that would be impossible because Martin is dead. Mary answers, "I know, but I would like to see him in his coffin." A strange request indeed for an 11-year-old girl, as strange as Mary Bell herself. Mary Flora Bell was born on May 26, 1957, in Gateshead, on the far side of the Tyne River.
When Betty gave birth to Mary, she did not know who the father was, or she claimed to not know who the father was. She was only 17, and apparently, the moment that Mary was born,
no one to Betty to hold but her the first time,
Betty said, "Take that thing away from me."
Dun,
dun, now, that's not a strong foundation for a mother-child relationship. And that was the beginning. That was just the beginning. It was going to get worse.
The Bells would eventually move to the other side of the river, in Newcastle upon Tyne. This was where Mary would befriend Norma Bell, a girl 2 years older than herself, who lives in the house next door. The young girls are considered bad company, and other parents in the neighborhood don't especially like their daughters to play with these two. Both girls are often implicated in shady goings-on.
There was one incident that took place in a sand pit where 3 little girls were playing. Norma and Mary showed up, and Mary told the 3 girls to leave. When they didn't leave, she walked one by one methodically and began to choke the little girls, grabbing them by the neck, not just pushing them, but squeezing. And one of the girls says that Mary not only grabbed her by the neck, but she took handfuls of sand and forced them down her throat, trying to choke her, trying to cut off her air. That's hardcore. That's serious violence.
At 7 p.m. on July 31st, 1968, Pat Howe, who is babysitting his 4-year-old half-brother Ryan,
I won that.
Informs police
now I got it.
The 14-year-old
14-year-old is panic-stricken and afraid something serious might have happened to her.
They're inside. As it gets dark, the community becomes involved. Everybody is on the search for Brian. Nobody can find him anywhere. Eventually, the police are called. At 11 at night, the police locate Brian.
Mm-hmm. Easier than he thought.
He could have fallen. No,
these guys are just giant space turtles.
At first, those concrete slabs are huge.
During the autopsy, the forensic pathologist, Dr. Bernard Tomlinson, notes that there are faint bruises on the child's throat. Apparently, Brian has been strangled. But the faintness of the marks suggests that the murderer is also a child.
It was obvious there was a struggle.
Oh, you hear that? DOS is more complicated. Shit. He did not just say that.
He had puncture marks in his legs. He had been mutilated in his stomach.
Once his examination is done, Dr. Tomlinson strongly recommends that the police investigators concentrate their search for the perpetrator on the neighborhood children. Acting on the forensic pathologist's recommendations, Inspector James Dobson orders his men to meet with neighborhood children and ask them, with their parents' consent, to fill out questionnaires on their whereabouts for the last 24 hours.
A few children stood out because of their answers. One was Norma Bell, the other was Mary Bell.
The police officer who visits the residences of the two young girls is intrigued by Norma and Mary's attitude. He suspects that they are hiding something. He mentions this to Dobson, who agrees to focus all attention on the two girls. Dobson first interrogates Norma, the weaker of the two. She starts by denying everything, and then breaks down and confesses. It was Mary who dragged little Brian Howe into the field and strangled him. She was also the one who had murdered little Martin Brown. That same evening, it is Mary Bell's turn to be interrogated. She denies everything. She has nothing to do with the two murders and loudly claims that Norma is a liar.
But the final straw was the day of Brian passed funeral. Everybody was there grieving.
Ghosts there.
Beside themselves with sadness over his death, except for one person. Mary Bell was standing there, laughing, rubbing her hands together. She could not contain herself. She was in glee at the sight of Brian's coffin.
Inspector Dobson interrogates her again.
Got my Red Bull Sparrow doing tricks up in the desert.
She admits to being present during the crimes, but it was Norma who committed the murders, not her. With two contradictory versions, the inspectors left no choice but to charge both girls for the murders of Brian Howe and Martin Brown. The trial of Norma and Mary Bell opens before a judge in Newcastle upon Tyne on December 5th, 1968.
At the trial, Mary Bell and Norma Bell were both tried at the same time. Norma sat there in tears. She covered her head with her hands. She was confused. She was overwhelmed. She did not know what this was about. She was scared. But Mary never cried during trial. She never showed remorse. She never...
Oh, up there.
It was almost like it was a game for her.
Numerous experts are called to testify. Their conclusions are unanimous. Mary Bell is a psychopath. It would take years before we would learn the sordid details of Mary Bell's childhood, thanks to the tireless work of British journalist Gitta Sereny, the author of two books on the case.
Mary had witnessed a lot of horrible things in her young life. She witnessed her mother's sadomasochistic tendencies, or talents, I should say, when as a prostitute. She probably saw her mom throttle clients.
Her mother, Betty Bell, is a prostitute who forces her daughter to participate in perverted sexual games with her clients. Mary Bell might be a psychopath, but she is also a broken little girl deprived of a normal childhood. But in 1968,
we're gonna leave?
The members of the jury, seven men and five women, take less than 4 hours to find Mary
Bell. Oh, I died.
For For her part, Norma Bell is found not guilty.
Wow. Not the easiest mission. Well, I guess Mary Bell, now 23,
is released in 1980. She goes on to marry the year after, and later gives birth to a little girl. She has never committed another crime, and is eventually forgotten. The media in general are quick to forget the victims, and after a while they also forget the murderers themselves. But Mary Bell's criminal childhood has also been forgotten. Since no one knows exactly what happened to her after she was released, we can only speculate on Mary Bell's reintegration into society. However, the fact that she has never again been involved in a similar crime is rather encouraging. Yet it would be hasty to conclude from this particular case that psychopaths can be cured. The history of crime is unfortunately full of cases where psychopathic killers, once released, even after long years in therapy, do ultimately repeat. Sadly, Mary Bell's case is the exception, and Peter Woodcock's the rule. Peter Woodcock is taken into questioning for the murder of Carol Boyce at the North York Police Station on January 21st, 1957.
It wasn't spectacular police work that got him arrested. It was, he was sloppy in the sense that he, you know, he had all these witnesses. There were a bunch of kids who saw him. The bike tracks. There wasn't one cop who was able to at least put together some forensic evidence in terms of making a cast of his bicycle track. But the, I've seen the composite picture, which is printed in the newspapers in Toronto, and it does look just like him. So I think the pro was pretty much ready off the hook at the police station for people who went to school and he went to and stuff.
Oops, this is the end of the line.
Later that evening, he admits to his crimes and signs two complete confessions. At that moment, his greatest fear is not going to jail for the rest of his life.
Even when he was committing his crimes, his one fear was not being caught, but that his mother would find out. We'll get in until we
win the game more time. On the basis of his
really? I have a funny feeling. Okay, I'll just open and maybe close it. Oh, yeah, it came open. Before being transferred to a psychiatric. Whoa! Drive away!
There soon come to the same conclusion as the policeman. He is a psychopath who does not grasp the seriousness of his actions and who is incapable of any remorse. The outcome of the trial would not be hard to predict.
In 1957, his trial came to an end, and the judge found him not guilty by reason of insanity. And he was sent to the maximum security psychiatric institution at Penetanguishene. In 1957, nobody had ever been released alive from that institution. It was made very clear to him that he would never get out, that he was going to Penetanguishene forever.
Peter Woodcock could have drifted into oblivion or been swallowed up by the complexities of the justice system, but this was not to be.
He began to realize there was some hope of him being more than just a stored away piece of livestock. And he began to become more sort of socially active in the institution that he was at. Instead of being sort of locked in a cell all the time, he began to take part in the different therapies. There were LSD therapies, the therapies involving the crowding of men into a small room, sort of a black hole of Calcutta situation that would go on for weeks so they could try to sort of bond with each other.
In the decades that followed, Woodcock, who would officially change his name to David Michael Kruger, undergoes all sorts of therapy. But he continues to entertain strange fantasies and still pretends to be in touch with his imaginary Winchester Heights Street gang. In 1988, in spite of numerous misdemeanors, but above all, despite repeated warnings from Dr. Russell Fleming, head of psychiatry at the Oak Ridge Institute, Woodcock, now Kruger, is transferred to the Brockville Psychiatric Hospital, a medium security prison, so he can undergo more therapy. There, he befriends a certain Bruce Hamill, a psychotic killer, age 31.
Bruce Hamill was a very troubled man from Ottawa, and Bruce had been involved in drugs and had friends who were also quite troubled in Ottawa, and basically lost his grip on reality, killed an elderly woman who was a school caretaker just around the corner from his house, which is actually right across from the Governor General's house in Ottawa. So Bruce Hamill went to Penetang, got a lot of treatment, was very cooperative, was released and got a job as a security guard in Ottawa, and was a good friend of David Michael Kruger. And he was such a good friend that he became David Michael Kruger's visitor when Kruger transferred to the Brockville Psychiatric Hospital.
In 1991, hospital psychiatrist Dean Woodcox, alias Kruger, ready to move back into society. He is now admissible for supervised leaves for a few hours at a time. It should be added that the Ontario government at this time is exerting a lot of pressure to deinstitutionalize mental patients like Woodcock. To be eligible for such temporary leaves, Woodcock, now 52, simply has to be accompanied by a guardian of his choice. He chooses none other than his good buddy, Bruce Hamill, recently released himself. And, as incredible as it seems, Hamill's application gets accepted. On July 13, 1991, Hamill shows up at Brockville Hospital to pick up Woodcock.
What happened in June 91 that changed both their lives? There are very few people who can control the mind of another person to the point where they can get that person to kill for them. And I can only think of two people off the top of my head. One is Charles Manson, and the other is David Michael Kruger. Kruger told Bruce Hamill that Kruger had connections with other world people who could solve Bruce Hamill's problems. All that Bruce Hamill had to do was follow Kruger's instructions. So Kruger told Bruce to show up with some weaponry at the Brockville Psychiatric Hospital. So Hamill went down from Ottawa to Brockville, went to the Canadian Tire, bought a pipe wrench and a hatchet and a machete and some other stuff, showed up at the Brockville Psychiatric Hospital, and they just started allowing Kruger to go out on day passes from the hospital. So he Hamill showed up at the hospital front desk, dropped this sleeping bag full of weapons on the counter, said, "I'd like to sign up my friend
balls.
David Michael Kruger," and they said, "Well, sign here." So off the two of them went to the Brockville Psychiatric Hospital. He'd like to talk, and he had talked to Hamill into helping him kill another inmate at the Brockville Psychiatric Hospital, a guy named Dennis Kerr. Kerr was yet another troubled person, which is sort of par for the course, and it's probable that he had been resisting the sexual advances of Kruger. So he conned Hamill into doing the heavy lifting of killing this guy, which was a brutal, brutal murder. Hamill went into this killing believing that if he did the killing, he would be taken up to some place in the sky by aliens, and his mind would be cured, and he would be free of the troubles that he had. So they killed Dennis Kerr, and then Kruger fed Hamill a bunch of Nidol sleeping pills. Hamill got into sleeping bag.
I think that's it.
Kruger walked over to the police station, walked in and said, "I just killed somebody." And the cops went, "Really?" And they went back to the psychiatric hospital, and they found the body of Dennis Kerr, and they found Bruce Hamill's story in a sleeping bag right next to it.
Woodcock and Hamill are arrested and detained. The two killers are sent back to Oak Ridge, the maximum security psychiatric institute Woodcock should never have left in the first place. Since then, Peter Woodcock, aka David Michael Kruger, has been imprisoned in Oak Ridge. There is precious little likelihood that he will ever benefit from another attempt at social reintegration. All the better for us.
Not much longer. No.
What?
I said no.
Good choice. Excellent. I hope it helps. See you again, I hope. What brings you here this morning? Thank you. Time's running out, Guardian. Not for our sake, but for those who will be born
accordingly.
Good morning, Guardian. Take care of that ship for me. How's these look to you? It's fast. Hey, don't let anything happen to that ship of yours.
Zer has been in the tower again.
Hey, hon. New ship today? I fixed this one up myself. So long, Guardian.
Guardian. Good morning. So long. How's it flying, huh? Morning, Guardian. Hope it treats you well. Good luck out there.
Warlock profiles? Ah.
Hey, Hunter. Looking for a new set of wings? Beautiful ride. Thank you. Straighten up and fly right.